Before I start, I would like to request the members of the audience to post their questions, if they have any, during the session on the right side of the screen in the Q&A dialog box. Moving on to the last session of Day 2 at Charcha 2021, the theme of this session is Corporate Social Responsibility, Creating Impact Through Skill Development. The panelists are Vikas Yadbendu, Group Head, CSR, ArcelorMittal, Nippon Steel, India; Vinita Malhotra Jha, Executive Vice President, Research and Academics, Clinical Directorate, Max Healthcare; Rajiv Gupta, GM and Head, Business Development, Jindal Stainless. The session will be moderated by Venkatesh Sarvasiddhi, who is Senior Head, Industry Partnership at National Skill Development Corporation. In his role, he is heading Digital Skills, Innovation, Industry Partnerships, and CSR Engagements in Building the Policy and Framework for Skilling Mission in India. He also heads eSkill India under the Digital India Initiative to empower the youth. May I now request Venkatesh to introduce the panelists and begin the session. Over to you, Venkatesh.
Thank you, Ishita, and a great afternoon to everyone who's joined us, especially the panelists and also the audience. It's a pleasure having you, and also this alliance with the Independence Day, which we will be celebrating tomorrow. It's a great occasion. And this panel would bring in those interesting insights from CSR, which would benefit a lot of audience who are listening to us today. I would love to welcome the key panelists who have joined: Dr. Vikas Yadubendu, the Group Head CSR for ArcelorMittal Nippon Steel. We also have Dr. Vinita Malhotra Jha, the Executive Vice President, Clinical Directorate, Max Healthcare, and Mr. Rajiv Gupta, the General Manager and Head of Business Development for Jindal Stainless Steel. You know, as we, moved into the tough and uncertain times, CSR becomes more and more relevant. We have seen that. And personally, heading the CSR function at NSDC, I have seen a lot of active contribution and participation from the industry, especially during the pandemic times, where some of those individuals and organizations have completely come forward to help and see how to fix, especially the healthcare scenarios, healthcare situations. We launched very interesting initiative, which was also inaugurated by the Honorable Prime Minister, called COVID Warriors recently. So there's a lot of action in this space, and I would love to understand from each of you various areas where you are contributing back to the ecosystem. How are you engaged with various grants, philanthropic institutions, and engaged in delivering key deliverables around your CSR, your focus areas and all? So we would start with Dr. Vikas Yadubendu, the Group Head for CSR, ArcelorMittal and Nippon Steel. So Mr. Vikas, if you look into the current situation, uncertain times, situations where things have been changing, there are two waves and India is again anticipating the third wave. You know, what does, in this kind of an uncertain situations, what exactly does CSR mean for corporates? And has the role of CSR evolved, to take on this, pandemic current and, dynamic situation, which is like every now and then keep changing? What are your views on the CSR from your perspective, as well as from your organization perspective, if you can highlight some of the initiatives?
Thank you, Venkatesh, first of all, for having me as a panelist, and NSDC for this opportunity. Going to your question, the CSR space as such, in terms of the implementation and strategies, has changed a lot due to this pandemic. Of course, the planned initiatives, the priorities has changed due to the during the COVID times, as most since India as a whole, we were struggling with lot of challenges in medical care. So the priorities was immediate to focus on the COVID responses. So as ArcelorMittal Nippon Steel, with the state government, district administration, we did lot of COVID work. As we have set up a dedicated COVID hospital in Gujarat, which was inaugurated by Chief Minister, and we have also given the oxygen cylinders, which we imported from China, and given to the state governments, around 7,000 of that. Besides that, providing all the PPE kits and support system to the healthcare doctors, frontline workers. So there was a host of initiatives which was taken by ArcelorMittal Nippon Steel. During the first wave, we also contributed 100 crores jointly with HMEL to PM Care funds. So we did a lot of efforts during the COVID times. If you ask the impact about our CSR, what we are doing in the skilling space as such, as our topic is, you know, CSR creating impact through. So we are provide, as you know, recently on 12th of August, we ventured into a partnership with you, with NSDC, for skilling 800 youths in four states. So this is one of the, we have started this journey with NSDC, and we hope this, there will be a more strategic, frequent dialogue to in strengthening the skilling sector. And during COVID times, the implementation mode, as you know, there are three golden rules, you know, maintaining social distancing. There was a different lockdown across the states and the government. So digital has taken a lot of new move in doing implementation of activities. So technology has taken a place, and we have to leverage with the technologies and the way of executing our CSR project. So more and more technology, tech-driven digitalization. So these are now the strategies that we as ArcelorMittal, and I hope every company is now is moving forward to it. So we as a CSR, we require any corporates or any for effective, it requires effective partnerships, right? The skilled ecosystem, as you see in CSR, many companies are doing, even we are doing skilling directly with our own, like we have set up a ArcelorMittal Nippon Steel Lok Vikas Kendra. So Arcelor in Lok Vikas Kendra, we intend to provide a short-term courses on tailoring and stitching for the rural women. And besides that, we have also formed adolescent resource centers, like for teen, we call it as a teen circle. Teens means a girl aging from 13 to 19. So we also provide a short-term vocation in term like beauty therapy or soft toys making. So these trainings are imparted. So we have got a good role models also from this, who have started their own enterprise in their local village and earning out of it. So good is small success stories are also there. But the challenges is to scale up these initiatives. So to scaling it up, a certification is required. A lot of investment is required. So to get what I feel to have a proper impact, you required a right partner, right partners to reach out, to scale up our initiative, and to have a better impact. So that is what we are intending and moving forward to it. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Vikas. And I think the kind of partnership which we recently established, we will be able to help you scale. You'll be happy to know, in fact, out of 855 districts, India has, NSDC has a presence in more than 740 of them. We have a great coverage. And I think that's the scale which can really help you, you know, in terms of spreading your programs, you know, to the nook and corner. We'll almost we cover most of the districts. That's a kind of an opportunity and a collaboration between ArcelorMittal and NSDC. You know, we can leverage the scale we have, and we, of course, we can strengthen some of your programs for better outreach. Moving on to Dr. Vinita Malhotra Jha, welcome. We welcome you on the panel. And,
Thank you. Good evening.
It's a pleasure to see that you guys are doing fabulous work, especially in the COVID times. In the recent past, we launched COVID Warriors. Honorable Prime Minister announced that, and we have seen the launch. We are going through a lot of uncertain times. You know, we have seen second wave hit most of us, you know, and now there's a possibility of a third wave as per some of the reports. In this current times, you know, how are the organizations geared up to leverage CSR, especially CSR interventions that can help healthcare system to become more equipped. Your thoughts on this and your call for action in the current times from a CSR healthcare perspective.
Thank you, Venkatesh. Thank you for having me on the panel. I think very relevant and very pertinent question. Whilst CSR and organizations of various kinds have been working together for a very long time, I think COVID brought to the forefront one of the neglected areas in partnerships. And I'm thankful to the Honorable Prime Minister for having put across these core programs and the core need of the hour, which is the COVID warriors. There is a huge discrepancy. If you look at what is happening in the tier one cities and the larger institutions and the larger organizations, they have largely been really geared up to take control of any emergencies and any disasters that might come across, and COVID being a pandemic of a lifetime that none of us had seen. We in India were very lucky. We got a grace of some 3-4 months before the first wave hit India, and that was a very small wave and did not hit across India, did not sweep across India. So, it gave us a lot of time. It gave us a lot of time to train people, to teach people, to take learnings from other countries. And all good organizations actually took advantage of that time, especially in healthcare, to actually gear up on processes. Because COVID being a very, very specific area, otherwise, when it comes to skilling and upskilling, they are largely simpler issues to deal with, because we have a large youth presence that is willing to get trained, that wants to get involved. They're hungry to work. COVID threw us different challenge because the training for COVID was to be very, very different. Also, any gearing up that happened during a national lockdown. So again, mobilization of youth, their access to public transport to be able to reach to their place of work. All that was a challenge. However, having said that, the first wave was not a very difficult one. And even if you look at the magnitude of the first wave, it came in bits and pieces. It hit some pockets of the country first. It unfortunately hit the larger cities first. And organizations in larger cities were largely geared up to face the onslaught as it came. We at Max had actually, trained all the semi-skilled workforce that we have and the skilled workforce, which is, doctors and nurses is one part, but everybody else who comes under the gamut of everyone else who helps us and who are a core help force, without them, you cannot run any hospital. They are an integral part. They're as important as doctors and nurses. So, training them, mobilizing them, ensuring that they were able to come to work and, be able to deliver, because obviously everybody was scared for their own life. And, everybody's livelihood and life were equally important, and it was a great difficulty, but fortunately we did not face many challenges, and we were able to train many more people. I think the challenges in this country were faced when we saw the last wave, which is the one that came in April, because it came very quickly. It swept across large, small cities. And when we talked to our friends and colleagues in various healthcare institutions in tier two and tier three cities, that's when you actually realize and you look at the glaring gap of expertise and competence. And it's an irony. A lot of these young people who work with us, they actually come from small cities and small towns and small villages. But when COVID hit those towns, those villages, there was really nobody who was trained. Everyone was exposing themselves to each other. So that training in that space did not happen. In those geographies did not happen. Also because they were not really hit by the first wave so much as we were. So we were very cautious in big cities. In smaller cities, they were not cautious. And I think that is what we need to do. One of the biggest things is, yes, most good organizations, including Max Healthcare, our skilling team, and including those of all other good organizations that are doing a lot of good work, they have credibility in this space, we are all able to train. And I think the description of the job roles has made it much easier. I think what needs to be really addressed is, from a long-term perspective, is to be able to skill people in tier two and tier three cities, and then also be able to provide some kind of employment there and then. And, you know, as my colleague, Dr. Vikas, I was hearing him, technology has become a big enabler. You know, earlier that was a challenge. You know, you couldn't expect them to travel to bigger cities and bigger centers and get trained and go back, because that never works. Now with technology, somebody could be sitting anywhere. I mean, people have been doing classrooms and you have blended modules, even with NSDC now, we know that you guys also propagate hybrid modules of learning. So I think we as institutions, as healthcare partners in training, are really geared up, to be able to train people. You know, we've now got the experience and expertise behind us. And, training, not just training them to actually look after patients, but also themselves and their families, which is, again, a very important part and a social responsibility for the youth that we train in this area and given where they come from. So those are my initial thoughts, Venkatesh.
Yeah, I think that's a very interesting thought, especially the country like India, where we need more of these technicians, more of lab testing people, and this is where we were falling short, especially in the second wave. In some cities, it has not spread to the rural places much, but the third wave, in anticipation of that, in the kind of work that is getting done either by Max or by other healthcare groups, is very, very essential in the current times. And also I've seen heading the CSR for NSDC during the second wave, a lot of groups like Jindal, or Tata's, or Amazon, in fact, or Microsoft, they come forward to supply concentrators and, the equipments are there, but we need somebody to manage and operate those. That was an important thing. You know, you can access oxygen cylinders, but you need a technician who can help you fix that, who can monitor that. So I think filling that gap with COVID Warrior, what was launched by Honorable Prime Minister recently, which is one of our NSDC's mainstream engagement right now to build talent, the pool of resources which are required in healthcare. I think, as you rightly touched upon, it's very important to build that for the futuristic perspective, and also help them to deal with those situations and their families, because they also need to deal with their own safety and their own health at the end of the day during the pandemic times. Thank you so much for your thoughts. Moving on to Rajiv Gupta. Rajiv Gupta is the general manager and head of business development at Jindal Steel. My question to you is, skill development is one of the best means to achieve sizable impact and strategic imperatives. So in this context, can you tell us how Jindal Stainless, working towards a demand for skilled workforce, boosting our economy? We have seen some good days in the steel industry in the past few quarters. And what are the various initiatives from the CSR perspective Jindal is actually focusing on?
Thanks, Venkatesh. Thanks for giving us this opportunity, and NSDC. Jindal Stainless, is a little bit on the stainless steel industry. I mean, what exactly we are working. Stainless steel is the second largest industry in the world, in India. And we are the second largest manufacturer. We make close to 4 million tons of stainless steel every year. And there are almost 5 lakh people who are employed, not only in the direct prime industry, but in the downstream industry, who are making various products in stainless steel and supplying it to the consumers. And in last 5 years, specifically to the question what you've asked, I'll touch upon what we are doing in the skill development. In last 5 years, we touched many of the small fabricators who are making household gates and railings in various parts of the country. And these small fabricators had been trained by us. Roughly around 9,600 fabricators we trained in last 5 years. And the purpose of that was when they are doing welding, finishing and polishing applications, and if they are not doing it properly, the final product doesn't look good and it impacts their sales as well as their business. So once we are upskilling them, once we are providing training to them, they are able to improve the quality of the product what they are making, and thereby they are also able to increase their livelihood and their income from this particular business. Second thing, what we have done recently in the last 1.5-2 years, along with NSTC and Capital Goods Sector Skill Council, we have developed the course on the stainless steel fabrication. Now, this course is approved by NSTC, and what this is going to help is all these small fabricators who are 8th or 10th pass will get a certification, which they were not getting it earlier. And many of them just got the reference from their friends and from their relatives and developed these skills. But once they get the structured skilling exercise, once they get the training from the NSTC partners, their skills definitely will improve and will definitely impact their business. Now, this what we have started. In fact, we have conducted some programs also now, just pre-COVID, just before the second wave of the COVID. And some 10-12 programs we conducted. We reached around 300 fabricators who were trained. And believe us, I mean, when they got the certificate, they really felt so happy that, yes, I mean, for many of them, it was the first certificate of their life, which they were getting it. So these small people or these small fabricators, there are plenty. I mean, there are more than 2-2.5 lakhs in the country, and serving us almost every household where the gates and railings are being made. And this program is also being extended to the industrial belt, where small MSME and even the medium, the small industries, their workers are also being trained, and we are taking it to the small industries as well. Apart from this, a lot of other contributions what Jindal Stainless is doing through CSR activities. One is that during the COVID phase, we started a hospital of 500 beds, which was dedicated. Oxygen was diverted for the patients. And that time, definitely the focus was not on the production. It was to save the lives of the people. And whatever oxygen we were producing and oxygen plant, it was dedicated for the health work. And a lot of people in Hisar and even in the nearby cities took oxygen from our plant. And that was supplied to various people. And apart from that, we do have a hospital in Hisar where our main plant is coming in, which is definitely serving the entire society. There are a lot of other projects which Jindal Stainless is running. We are contributing a lot in the agriculture project, where some of the schemes what we are running in Rajasthan, Haryana, Uttarakhand, and Odisha, where we are trying to reach 80,000 farmers, trying to help them with the water harvesting, trying to provide them the pumps so that they can have the sufficient water to do the farming. We are also working extensively in the women entrepreneurship, where a lot of tailoring, beauty centers, boutiques, individual shops, Jindal Stainless has really helped them through the CSR funds and have given the livelihood so that they can start their own work and can really expand. Especially when we look at our plants, they are coming from the rural cities, and we are working extensively in the rural development as well. We are providing a lot of water kiosks in waste management, in setting up the solar management system so that the power is available and it can be there in the different villages. And we are part of UNGC. We are the governing council member, and we are also really contributing in terms of various programs what government is offering. And a lot of employees voluntarily as well as on the roles, they are contributing towards CSR. And apart from that, even the legal aid, we are also giving it to the various needy people who are looking for. So this is just a summary of various activities Jindal Stainless as a group is contributing towards the nation, towards the development. And coming back to the upskilling exercise, what we are doing it with the NSTC, this is just a start. We are looking for developing and upskilling many small to medium fabricators. And this definitely will help the entire society, and especially during the pandemic time, when a lot of these small people, they lost their jobs, they had to move to their cities back from the main metro cities. So this will be a important exercise for them to provide a livelihood and take it forward. Thank you.
Thanks. That's really nice to know a bunch of activities which are impactful, which are meaningful. for your sector, otherwise also. And I'm happy to hear the programs on diversity. So that makes meaningful impact. In fact, in the previous session we were sharing, you know, if we talk about a 5 trillion economy, if 1/3 of the female labor force comes back to the ecosystem and joins back to work, we would be a 30 trillion economy. That's the power of the female labor force coming back to the system. So any initiatives around CSR focused on diversity and inclusion means a lot, you know, in growing the economy, bringing them back to the ecosystem. So moving on from there to Dr. Vikas from ArcelorMittal Nippon, you know, we have seen a lot of organizations shift their CSR focus towards healthcare because of the pandemic. As we move, maybe, you know, post the pandemic kind of scenarios, which may take some time, do you think the organizations will again go back to that sectorial focus, or still they would be working on healthcare, which is a very important aspect, keeping in mind these pandemic situations? What are your views?
If you pre-COVID also, if you look upon the CSR, as you know, CSR is a law and 2% is a mandated spend. So large chunk of money was going to in the health and education thematic areas. Pre-COVID also, most of the companies were spending on health interventions and thematic areas. Health and education was the major chunk. And for like skill development and livelihood, it only counts around 10 to 15% of that total CSR contributions amount. So yeah, so it has further strengthened, further increased the spending on healthcare and focus due to COVID. So it will remain, as you know, still we are living with this threat. So the COVID will sustain, and I by now every company CSR has some plan for future third wave. So there is a special plan for COVID plan. I hope for each and like for ArcelorMittal, we have also made a separate plan for that. So I think the healthcare will remain a focus till this COVID or the spend and the activities around it. We are also doing a lot in the health sectors. Like we have a project Arogyam, wherein we have a mobile medical units. We have a set up a community health dispensaries in the remote locations. We also conduct, as you know, our operations are in the Dantewada, Sukma, these regions which are difficult terrain, and Malkangiri sector in one of the remotest locations. So we used to conduct a camps, health camps there. And you will not believe our team goes through a boat. They cross the river and conduct camp. So these healthcare is the basic necessity still in India in most of the rural parts. So health will be a priority. But going forward, if you see, the shift will change. Shift will change in more challenges that, as you know, India. Our larger chunk is a youth, so skilling, employability, because we talk about economy, skill-based economy has to be there if we want to develop. So things are changing. So spending on what I see in skill sector as well as will get a push. Like for ArcelorMittal Nippon Steel, we are also focusing. We have taken a theme for this year as a digital education and digital skin to give a push and for the national agenda as a digital India. So we are looking for a collaboration to have that larger impact and scale pan India. So this is one of the initiative which we ventured with NSDC. Further, we are also looking for to push the digital education space, like to set up, we have recently collaborated with government of Odisha on their flagship project. They have a Mo School program, Mo in Odia, in English, My School. So where there are different components of setting up of smart classes, e-library, ICT. So we have contributed. So we have will be contributing in 133 high schools across 6 districts of Odisha. Through we have a presence in 5 states of India, and we are reaching around 200 odd villages right now in our operational villages, and we touched around lives of more than 1 million people. So we will further strengthen our ongoing initiatives that are going on in these 200 villages, increasing our CSR footprint at national level in Pan India. On priorities of government like Digital India, Digital Education, Digital Skilling. So it will be more focused in picking up the initiatives. So I think the CSR will have a major shift in towards the skilling in digital space, and also encouraging the innovations R&D space. So these are the areas which are being not taken priorities, but companies will do take care of, has started thinking, and so year on year you will we are seeing as a spending pattern changes. So there is a change in outlook of CSR now. So health will be there, but in other sectors, a balanced contribution will increase.
So well taken. I think there should be focus of CSR towards healthcare, no doubt, but there should also be a balance on various engagements so that we can strike a balance overall. Moving on to Dr. Vinita, in fact, India has successfully administered more than 50 crore COVID doses. And we expect that, as per some statistics, they expect that 70% of the population would be at least be vaccinated, at least with one dose by November. They have also looking at a target of vaccinating the more than 70% by March 22 with the double doses. So, with the way it is going, there's also need of corporate CSR towards focusing on vaccination, and driving engagements and out. Programs focused around vaccinating people. I want to hear from you because you work with one of the prestigious institutions. How are these organizations and corporates or with that even philanthropic institutions coming to you to tie up in this initiative of vaccinating people? If you can share some thoughts.
Venkatesh, so we've done a lot of work, as you rightly said. We were one of the front runners when vaccination went private to the larger public. And we were, even before it went private, we were the government approved center for vaccination for a very long time. When it spread out to everybody, we played a dual role. One was, of course, being centers for vaccination and partnering with government and being able to provide not just infrastructure, but also staff, capable staff and competent staff who was able to do a good job in an efficient manner. We also trained over 1,000 vaccinators very quickly, because that again was the need of the hour. Because at that time, if you remember, we were just coming off the pandemic. And traditionally in India, it is either the ASHA workers or some of the rural social healthcare workers who were, part of vaccination campaigns. But those campaigns were never with injectable campaigns. So, for example, polio was polio drops. So really there was, it was the polio didi would come with the drops and, it worked. In this case, we suddenly needed a lot of people because the core healthcare staff that were trained and that were registered with the government and who the government allowed for inoculations were very few. So it really helped, that the government guidelines that came on vaccinations and vaccinators as well allowed people, paramedic staff who were maybe in different areas of medicines, they could be dialysis technicians, they could have been anyone else, an OT technician, and they were all upskilled very quickly within a short span of of time when we were upskilling the vaccination numbers. On the other piece, you know, so that is one is very important, you know, that we were able to upskill a large workforce who were able to vaccinate people, you know, and in large vaccination centers, as you can imagine, there was a large number of vaccinators required. The other piece which you touched upon was, you know, partnering with institutions through their CSR funding into vaccinating the marginalized sections of the society. And we continuously get requests to partner with them because I think we have the bandwidth and the credibility to be able to implement an effective and safe vaccination drive to large segments of society. And even in the cities where we operate, there is a large segment of marginalized society. Not everyone in large cities, you know, lives in, you know, rich or middle class urban areas. There is a very large section that is around us in a marginalized section. And even semi-rural within the large cities is available. And, you know, because of various reasons, there was, whether it was vaccine hesitancy or various other reasons, where they were unable to have access to vaccination, knowledge about the vaccination, awareness about the vaccination, whilst, you know, the government did do a lot to spread awareness. But I still feel that once a credible partner goes out to vaccinate, it does make a huge difference in a person's mind. You know, if it's a Max or an Apollo or in, for that matter, an Ames or a Maulana Azad or a reputed institute that goes out for vaccination versus watching something on TV. You know, there you have an individual standing in front of you. If you have questions, you can answer those questions. It makes it easy. So yes, we are partnering with multiple organizations and we are willing to partner with more, you know, because we will be able to not just procure the vaccines, but also be able to safely and in an efficient manner be able to vaccinate a large section of society.
Just to add Venkatesh to Dr. Vinita, recently we have partnered with Apollo for conducting vaccination camps. We have two iron ore mines at Odisha. So in our mines area and the facilities also a lot of truck drivers comes, you know, truck movement, transportation of mines that goes. So they are the most vulnerable section. So nobody pays the attention of the truck drivers. So we have taken this to vaccinate all the truck drivers coming to our through. We have got the list from the transporters. We will be recently conducting a camp and ensuring that all the truck drivers are vaccinated, and we will also extend to their families also if they are a local resident. And in MNS India employees, we have already procured vaccine directly from Serum Institute. And so all our employees are vaccinated, we conducted. And this vaccination was extended not only to employees, but to associates, to the business partners, to like even the securities, gardeners. So 100% first dose has been completed. As the time is, they are completing for second dose, we are vaccinating them.
That's very nice. That's good to know, Dr. Vikas. In fact, you know, we are seeing a lot of interest from philanthropic institutions like AIF, Susan Dell, and then Gates Foundations and others actively looking and talking to us in terms of various initiatives to vaccinate and to create an outreach. In fact, in the beginning of the COVID, we've also partnered with Amazon in creating an awareness session, because in India, unlike the top cities and the tier one, tier two, there are a lot of villages where still they have their own doubts regarding vaccination, how safe it is, whether it is good, whether it is bad, and educating them. And also we face the problem of, you know, to customize the content. So most of the COVID content is in English or Hindi. We need to customize it into vernacular languages so that everybody can understand. As Dr. Vinita said, the credibility of organizations who are reaching out, that also makes a lot of difference. So, you know, these are certain things, you know, I think everybody is trying to address. Hopefully we should be there, you know, vaccinating more than 70 people by November. 70% of the Indian audience. But again, you know, I would request audiences and organizations which are listening to come forward and support us in this drive. So every contribution from your organization as individuals, as mentors, would be a meaningful intervention in vaccinating the entire India and making them safe. So now moving on to the next question to Dr. Rajiv, Mr. Rajiv Gupta from Jindal Stainless. As you have contributed in developing a new module in the stainless steel fabrication side, the training modules have been developed with Capital Goods Sector Skill Council and government's Skill India program. Can you take us through some of the importance of this skill-based training and how it will help an individual in securing jobs?
Venkatesh, it's a very important factor when I say that the upskilling or having a structured course, what is required for our workforce. Many times what happens is the kind of skill levels which is required by a worker is not there and he's not able to produce the right product. And that definitely hampers his business. He's not able to get the new business or the new opportunity which he's looking for. Now, if you look from this angle and when we compare the worldwide fabrication levels also, it's a very important part where we are able to at least bring the worker at a level where he is able to produce a good quality product. And second thing which I just want to bring it here, when I'm looking at the institutes also, there is a lot of gap between institutes and the industry. So whatever equipments we are using at the industry, the same kind of equipments are not available or not being used in the colleges also. So the person who after passing out from ITI or even from the other colleges, they are not, they find the industry quite different. So this upskilling is required and that way it will definitely contribute. Now, once the people start getting a certificate where they have been recognized by a government institute, it adds a lot of value. And once it adds value, so I'm sure a lot of industry people are willing to employ them and it will generate a lot of employment for them. One other exercise, what we really did was during pandemic or even before that as well, many times the fabricators or the workforce is not able to reach the training centers or to the places what we are looking for. So we have 4 vans which are running in different locations and they provide on-site training to these people. And all these vans carry sufficient tools, whatever is required for welding, finishing, and at the site itself, they provide the training to them. So not only in the urban area, but in the rural areas and the cities where the sufficient facility is not available, we are trying to reach them as well. The other important factor, what as a company we are looking for, not only for the workforce, but for the engineers also, we are providing a sort of a training, as well as there is a program which is running in the engineering colleges in various IITs, various other engineering colleges, where there is an elective program where anybody has an interest for the metals, for the stainless steel, they can definitely have that elective course and gain more knowledge on the material. So this is, we are trying to bridge the gap between the industry and the institute at engineering level, as well as, I mean, what I just mentioned for the workers in upskilling them. So all these activities definitely will improve the employability of a person. And I'm sure that with the large kind of downstream industry, what we have, it will provide a lot of employment opportunities to them as well.
Thank you. That's a good set of initiatives what you're doing, and also the programs what you explained about academic institutions adopting some of these to bridge the industry academia gap also to drive employability of students and all makes a meaningful intervention. So in interest of time, we are already at 4:47. There are a lot of audience who joined us today. There are organizations which are implementing partners. There are organizations which are in the area of CSR related work. And there are also organizations who are philanthropic institutions. So one key message, Dr. Vikas, from your side to set of audience who have joined in today. You're on mute.
So the message for my side would be that we should bring the innovations. We should the skill, the CSR should contribute more and more in terms of pushing the innovation, digitalization in the space, whether it is education, skill sector, which is very much required to take India forward as the COVID pandemic continues. So this technology push is very much required. They should and the in terms of developing that strategy and a separate plan for COVID, so that their ongoing efforts or plan should not be disturbed because of the COVID interventions. So COVID and these COVID planning should be separate with the existing CSR plan. I look, but what I see a very progressive and looking forward approach, which in the recent time organizations, various organizations, whether ArcelorMittal or the other companies in metal and mining sectors are doing. So the things are still moving, and I expect that India Inc. will contribute as much as it can, and ArcelorMittal as a company is intent to contribute in the development and partner with the national agendas and priorities and contributing more and more for the society. Thank you.
Okay. Dr. Vinita, your message to all the, especially the healthcare workers, organizations, large mile implementing agencies, your key message to them.
So, we will certainly say that the whole role of skilling, upskilling, reskilling is here to stay. We are also very grateful to all the industry partners for having supported healthcare overall, per se, in every which way. Rajivji just mentioned about oxygen supplies and organizations that stepped up and the game with us. Without that, that would not have been possible. Let's not forget that, even before COVID, infectious diseases in India saw greater mortality than even our, cancers and heart diseases. And again, there is sickness prevalent in our society. And if we continue to invest in skilling the youth, in entering the healthcare space, this space will be one of the largest. It will continue to be one of the largest employers of youth. So this is an area where we are not just going to give them a skill for life, but also a working opportunity, an employment opportunity, and also indirectly upgrading their own standard of living. Because once you work in healthcare and you actually understand and realize the importance of being healthy, safe and clean, it actually indirectly uplifts the whole society. So very grateful to the industry for having partnered with us. Please continue to support us, and we will continue to support the skilling and upskilling of youth in this area, and also invite partners in their placements. Like I said, tier one being saturated, if we can all collectively look at solutions for tier two and tier three, upskill the youth, make them able to work in areas that need them most, because even now the larger population of India lives out of tier two, tier three and small villages and towns and not through tier one. So if we can collectively work to address that gap, I think that will be a huge success. One last thing also, I would say that along with education in healthcare and skilling in these key areas that are COVID related, one big thing that came to the forefront in COVID was the importance of clinical research. And we are actually working at Max specifically in a lot of capacity building in healthcare research. And we would invite partnerships because ultimately India also has to step up the game in healthcare research. Today we are led by international players, but tomorrow there is no reason if we are able to do capacity building as a nation in healthcare research, in public health, in epidemiology. And I would therefore want the industry to even think of partnering with us in those areas. So thank you very much, Venkatesh.
I think, Dr. Vinita, one of the key things you touched upon is how India should be prepared for a larger skilling up in the healthcare segment as such, whether it is diagnostics, whether it is pharma, whether it is the hospitals, the last mile delivery centers, or even in the areas of telemedicine. And there's a lot of technology driven medical advancements which are getting done. And overall, also to increase this spend in the R&D perspective, which is very important, whether it's from the pharma side or in the clinical trials, because that will position India not just to meet our needs, but also we will be able to establish a leadership position in the world. And a lot of countries require actually the talent. You know, we can even be in a better situation to push our talent to countries like Japan and all, where there are a lot of needs, especially in the healthcare. So thanks a lot for your thoughts. And going on to Rajiv, your thoughts, especially in bridging industry-academia gap, because Jindal does a lot of interesting interventions around building skill programs, launching modules with the sector skill councils and all. Your final message to all the youth who are present, who are looking for jobs.
Venkatesh, what I'd like to convey is that we should be working towards building an ecosystem where all the institutes, where all the colleges, industries really come forward in empowering youth to have the right kind of skills which can help them in getting an employment and the job in the years to come. So we are definitely contributing a lot, and we are working towards it, and we can help the youth in getting this kind of employment, in developing by having the right kind of skills. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Rajiv ji, for your message. And thanks to every panelist and also the audience. I wish you all a great Independence Day celebration tomorrow and a great weekend. And thank you, everyone. And if you have any questions, in interest of time, we have to end the panel. If there are questions, we can take them offline and circle back. Thank you so much, and have a great day and a great weekend and a great Independence Day celebration. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Venkatesh, for steering the session so productively. Thank you, panelists, for joining us today. Have a great, happy Independence Day.
Thank you, and to you all. Thank you.
You may now close the window to exit the screen.